Good evening, everybody. Robotics and other combinations will make the world pretty fantastic compared with today. By this, we welcome you all to the next session of Insights in 20, which is organized by IEEE Robotics and Automation Society of IEEE Student Branch Chapter NSSCE, SJCET, LBS ITW, and RAS Kerala Section. Firstly, we would like to express our gratitude to each and every one of you for the overwhelming response we received in our yesterday's session. Thank you so much. Moving on to our today's session, here we are with a 20-minute talk in modern robotics or automation technologies. For that, here we have an eminent personality, Sir Dr. Renjit R. Nair, who is the Assistant Professor of Electronics and Communication Engineering Department in IIT Pune. He is dealing with the topic multi-robotic system in today's talk. And guys, if you are up with any doubts or thoughts during the session, feel free to post them in the comment box. After the 20-minute session, sir will definitely clarify all your doubts. So it's time for us to start with the session. And once again, from the side of our team, Insights in 20, we welcome you, sir, to take over the platform and start with the session. Sir, please.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for the introduction and invitation. So let me share the screen first. I hope my screen is visible. Hello, is the screen visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, good evening, all of you. So, I hope you have already have sessions on robotic systems. And today I'm going to talk about multi-robot systems. So multi-robot system is one of the key research domain in robotics platform in the robotics. So there are lots of researches happened in this particular domain for the past one decade. If you look in literature, you can see that. So this is this shows the potential of this particular field. And I hope at least some of you are working in this field or you are aware of this field already. So as the name suggests, the multi-robot system is a system with multiple robots. So when you talk about multi-robot systems, so I think we should start from multi-agent systems. So the concept of multi-robot system has been derived from multi-agent systems. So this is a very common scene. There are many examples for these multi-agent systems around us in biological systems I'm talking about. So in case of flock of birds, school of fish, herd of animals. So these are some of the examples for multi-agent systems around us. Okay. Biological systems I'm talking about. So this is a V formation flight of bird. Okay, you have seen this actually, might be. So this is one of the biologists named Steve Ogle. He has done some experimentations with this V formation flight of birds. Till this small bird, small living being, traveling for kilometers and even sometimes crossing the continents, is it? So the energy efficiency was really interesting, fascinating factor that has driven the scientists to research in this area. And Steve Ogle, a biologist, he has some experimentations they implanted in herd monitors in white pelicans. So these are migratory birds. So he found that some of the aerodynamic benefits, some energy benefits for the birds when they fly in V formation. Okay, so especially for the trailing birds, it's free flying. So they don't need much energy. Their drag is very less. So their drag can be reduced for the trailing birds, but leading bird doesn't enjoy much benefits. So that apart from that, one of the interesting observation out of this study was that this individual decisions taken by this each member through local interactions is coming out as a global behavior. is it? So there is no one-to-one communication between all the members in this formation, but they're interacting only with the immediate neighbor, is it? Local interactions, their individual decisions are taken through local interactions only, that is it. So communication complexity is also very less, and even intelligence is delegated here, is it? So there are many interesting facts out of that, and even the researchers have tried to explore this concept and try to extend this from biological systems to artificial engineer systems. So this has paved the way for the emergence of this area of multi-agent systems. So there are lots of applications of multi-agent systems. It is not only in robotics field, everywhere. It's starting from the space systems and spacecrafts, multi-spacecraft systems, to you can say power systems in microgrids. So there are applications of multi-agent systems. So multi-agent system is nothing but multiple agents are there. They're cooperatively work together for a particular mission. Okay, so there will be delegation of intelligence, and again, then cooperative control will comes there. Okay, here we are, our application is in robotics field. So we have multiple robots over here to perform a particular task. So these are some of the swarming behaviors which we observe in biological systems. So flock joining the flock, path following the path, a particular path, right? So the mobile agents are there. So they have a path to be followed to reach the destination. So have the collision avoidance, right? So you need to avoid a collision between the agents. So that is a collision avoidance, internal collision. So coming to obstacle avoidance, avoid the obstacle, external obstacles in the environment. If it is working in a cluttered environment, so of course obstacle avoidance will come to a picture. Next is reconfiguration. So in the case of obstacle avoidance, sometimes the formation needs to be reconfigured. So these are some of the swarming behaviors which we use to see biological systems. We can mimic all these things in realistic robot systems also. So here, when we talk about robot systems, so the first question is why we need robot formation? What's the relevance of that? So there are some of the pictures I'm going to show you which remind you the relevance of this, or project the relevance of the multi-robot platforms. So these are some of the examples you can see over here, the bottom of the slide. So right bottom, you can see a cooperative transportation. Okay. It's a figure of cooperative transportation. Multiple robots are collaboratively working together for cooperative transport on object. So in that case, actual payload capacity, there's a limitation in the payload capacity for a single platform, is it? So we can employ multiple robots in that case. And even left bottom side, you can see another one in the case of any fire outbreak. So this cooperation being done with the help of multi-robot systems, this aerial robots, drones being deployed here. So you can see that for the risk operation, the fire outbreak. So these are some of the many n number of applications out there. I'm going to show a few more. So mainly we can divide these applications into military applications and civilian applications. So military, already it has been deployed. Multiple robots are been deployed for multiple purpose, surveillance, search, security, and all the operations. And civilian applications also been used. Power line patrol, like power lines, usually generating stations are like at remote locations. So power lines are coming to remote areas. So night patrolling is quite difficult manually. So we can deploy some drones for that. Single drone is quite difficult to cover up the area. So we can deploy multiple robots. Pipeline is one of the work which I've done in postdoc. So pipeline is something, oil, gas, and pipelines passing to desert lands for kilometers. So gas leakage detection and all, we can employ multiple robots. Drones, another has some, like disadvantage, like actually battery capacity is limited for that. So we need an onboard charging, mobile charging station also to be followed. So a multi-robot platform might be needed in that case for this pipeline patrolling and all the things. Okay, apart from an aerial system, we need a land rover also, working as a mobile charging station to perform that. Okay. The next is farm aerial screen. Big farmlands, it's quite difficult for a single robot to go and inspect them. Diseases and for the pesticide spraying also, there's some limitation for the area of coverage for a single platform, so we can deploy multiple robots over here. So forest fire suppression, all there are many applications are there, and even disaster security, surveillance, localization, so remote sensing, everything. Okay, so remote sensing is associated with spacecraft. Spacecraft is also an autonomous system, so we can include that in also in the robotic domain actually. So these are, there are a lot many applications are there, okay, for where actually multiple robots will perform better than a single platform. There are many advantages also, as you can see there, in terms of time and quality, adaptability and accuracy. In terms of that, actually, there are lots of advantages for a multi-robot system compared to a single platform. So the quality of the work can be improved, is it? Even if multiple robots are there, so even if one of the agent is going faulty, so we can actually continue the mission with the rest of the agents. So that is also, but for a single platform, if it fails, the mission will be failed. Satellite formation is one of the already implemented one. So rendezvous docking operations for International Space Station, interferometry for interplanetary studies and all. So low Earth orbiting satellites, low Earth orbits, basically we are deploying multiple spacecraft for the wide area of coverage. And for high data resolution, high resolution data extraction, also we can deploy multiple spacecraft platforms. So it's already been, there are many missions of multi-spacecraft systems by different space agencies. You can see. When you talk about multi-robot, little technical we are coming to. So actually, I will just explain about a few objectives of multi-robotic system designs. And then I'll come to some case studies, which I have done, the experimentations which I have done. And I'll come to that. Okay. So when you talk about multi-robot systems, these are the basic modules, like all other robotic systems. It has a perception module, it's a cognition module, it has an actuation module, right? So perception means it deals with all the sensing part. Nowadays, the major sensor is a camera, and there are different types of sensor. Depending upon the mission, we can integrate. And cognition is one of the most important module, and that's the intelligent part. Cognitive module, is it? So what makes the robot smart is basically the cognitive module. Absolutely, right? Of course, there are smart perception and actuation modules are also nowadays available, but still cognitive part will make the robot more smart. Many robots, multiple robots are there. They may have same hardware, but what make the robots more smart is the cognitive module. So we are concerned about the path planning and control of the multi-robot system. So when you are working with actuation, of course, you know, right? Actuation motors or hydraulic or pneumatic actuators. Nowadays, smart polymers are coming. Smart actuators are also being deployed nowadays, being used nowadays for robotic designs. So multi-robotic formation objectives, when you're designing multi-robot system, these are the major objectives we can see. We used to consider. One is like formation maintenance. Okay. Next is formation reconfiguration, maintaining the formation, reconfiguration sometimes, trajectory following. So robots has to follow a trajectory, obstacle avoidance. It has to avoid external obstacles when he's working with in a very cluttered environment. Then fault detection and isolation. That's very important. Resilience. So because the system is prone to faults, right? Not only the actuator faults, it can be sensor faults, there can be network faults, right? Uncertainties are everywhere. So the system should be adaptable, resilient to this type of faults. So fault tolerant control is one of the most important objective in multi-robot formation designs. Consensus, communication consensus-based formation. Multiple robots are there, the communication complexity has to be reduced, is it? So because while the individual decisions taken by each agent depends upon what the data coming from the neighboring agent. Right, so the communication channels and the complexity also affects the performance of the system. The efficacy of the system depends upon all these things. Network resilience means the resilience to network faults. When a robot is interacting to cyberspace or a local network, multiple robots are there. They are connected to the local network or internet. So in that case, there are many uncertainties can happen. One is like actually, if it is through internet, cyber attacks can happen. Next is like the packet loss, delay, there are many uncertainties are there, right? So system should be designed such a way that to deal with all this type of network uncertainties and all the unforeseen situations. So using this, so resilient control is also one of the research domain in multi-robot system. You can subdomain in multi-robotic system. So this is basically the all the systems. This is the basic control loop. I think you already know. I told you control is the major part, sub-module in the cognitive module. Okay. So control means to control the behavior of the system. We need a control module. And guidance means designing the desired trajectory for the robot. anything. If a robot is a mobile robot, so we have to design and then set path for the robot. So that path planning will come in guidance part. Control means make the robot to follow that path, the desired path. That's a function of control module. Navigation module means sensing part. Sensing part and some estimation things are also involved sometimes, because all the things are not directly measurable always. So all parameters cannot be directly measurable. So in that case, we need to estimate some things from the available measurements. So all the estimation algorithms, everything will come in navigation system. Communication module is also very important nowadays, because nowadays the robotics domain is going to cyber-physical robotics. Is it? So we are designing the system not only considering physical things, but also communication module as well, communication parameters also. So a very broad perspective we are designing the system. So the next is communication model. So formation architectures, when you talk about formation, there are three types of architectures. One is leader follower. Multiple robots are here. One is a leader and rest of the agents will follow the leader. That's called leader follower based formation. When the agents are in formation, the follower tracks the dynamics of the leader. Okay, when they are in formation. Behavior based approach means the formation as a whole, just try to mimic all these farming behaviors like flock joining, path following, collision avoidance, obstacle avoidance. All these farming behaviors are being exhibited in behavior-based approach. Apart from that, the control input to this each agent is basically the weighted average of the control inputs due to all these farming behaviors. Is it? Because it has to reach a goal. Robots has to reach a goal. It has to make a formation. It has to avoid the obstacles. Sometimes it may need to reconfigure, right? So we have to sum up all these things. All we have many multiple objectives out there. So control should be able to meet all these things. So control is basically weighted average of all this. Next is virtual leader-based approach. In virtual leader-based approach means formation as a whole acts as a rigid structure. There is no physical leader here, but there's a point in that structure is acting as a leader. So with respect to that point, all the positions of all the members have been defined in virtual leader-based approach. So these are the basic formation approaches. There are many research challenges in when you're working with multi-robot systems. There are many research challenges. One is like resource optimality, because we need lots of resources, communication resources we need. We need sensing requirements we have. We have actually, so these are the basic resources we need. So we need to optimize the use of this communication and sensing requirements. That way we need to design it. Okay. And again, the speed of convergence, adaptability to perturbations and disturbances, resilience, fault tolerance. These are some of the major objectives in when you're dealing with multi-robot systems. Dynamic weight allocation for different swarming behaviors. That's another thing. Okay, I told you when robots are navigating in a very cluttered environment, multiple robots are here. Sometimes robot has to is more concerned about goal seeking. To reach a goal point, but sometimes it's where obstacle avoidance is more critical. In that case, more weightage should be given for obstacle avoidance, is it? And sometimes collision avoidance is more critical. In that situation, collision avoidance should be given more weightage. So we have to dynamically allocate these weights for different swarming behaviors, collision avoidance, obstacle, or goal, depending upon the operating conditions. So that is again a decision-making problem in the multi-robot system designs. I'm skipping all these portions. So because the limit for this talk is only 20 minutes, I was told, it's quite difficult to include all the things. So if you are interested to know, of course, I can explain all the things, approaches, various control approaches and all, like time-triggered and event-triggered approaches. Time-triggered approach means, I'll show a block diagram and I'll tell you that. Many slides are there, but I'm not going to tell all the slides, explain all the slides. So time-triggered control means, of course, you know, right? We are controlling the behavior of a system. For a mobile robot, we are controlling the path, the position or velocity, or sometimes acceleration, depends upon the system dynamics. Time triggered control means at every clock instance, we are giving the control triggers. Event triggered control means we are not giving the control at some event instances. Whenever it is needed, then only control is updated. Otherwise, previous instant control has been given as input. And sensing is also like that. We are not sensing the data every instant, but at the event instances only data is sensed and been sent to the system. This is called event triggered control. And the first one is called time triggered control. And the second one is called event triggered control. Event is basically an event stability condition, particle condition. This condition is checked. When this condition is satisfied, then the sensor, we can connect a switch over here. Okay. The switch is open when this event is conditions are not satisfied. In that way, this can be implemented. So this can reduce the resource requirements. That's the advantage of this. Okay. Now I'm coming to the case studies. So the case studies, two case studies I'm just going to show here. So one is on fault tolerant formation control. There are multiple robots that are coordinating to perform a task. And again, one of the robot goes to faulty in real time. So how the how it can be managed, is it? So two types of faults can happen. There are multiple robots are here. So sometimes the fault can be major fault. In that case, the robot has to be isolated from the formation. Sometimes it is minor fault. So that case, the robot has to be, the mission has to be continued with the existing number of existing agents. So both the things to be dealt with. So for that, we are doing is for dealing with minor faults, the control is very adaptive controller we designed using fuzzy logic, fuzzy and sliding mode algorithm. And again, this can again cope up with any type of minor faults. But it's a major fault. In that case, what we're doing is, this time is limited, so I'm not going to explain these things in fuzzy based designs. So here, if it's a major fault, what we're doing is, it will detect faulty member. Okay. Every member actually will compute a residual signal every instant based on available control measurements. This residual signal is computed every instant and a flag is set, fault flag. If this condition is satisfied, that means it is faulty. Okay. This condition, this is a threshold has been kept, and U minus UM, U is a control, computer control input, and UM is a measured input, control input. It can be velocity or force or torque, whatever be for the control. Fault flag is set, and if a fault flag is set, it is communicated with the neighboring agents. Okay, and again, the neighboring agents will what will do? It will just it'll try to isolate that particular member and will avoid a collision with that member and will reconfigure. Okay, and all the things have to be taken by the path planning model. It is based on artificial potential based path planning scheme we have used over here. Artificial potential is a mathematical formulation. Okay, so just to so as to make this velocity to follow that first differentiable energy function, now that is basically APF based path planning. So I'm not going to do that. We are using a fuzzy based adaptive controller over here to adapt to this situation. Now I will show some video of this real time implementations of this work. Then I'll come back to this. And before that, I want to show one more slide. So then I will come to the video. Yes, here. So here you can see a communication topology. Here we have multiple robots are here. So the robots has to, one of the robot is a leader, and again, rest of the agents are called followers. So our leader has to follow, has to follow the leader, and they are collectively working together. They are collectively maybe navigating somewhere, or maybe collectively working together for corporate transportation. Can be different, objective can be different. Here, but you can see this is a communication topology. Zero is the leader. Zero is the leader, and 1, 2, 3 are the followers. You can see there is no one-to-one communication between all the members. You can see that leader data has been given to all the agents, 1, 2, 3. But from 1, information is given to 2, is it? And a 1 is receiving information from 0 and 3, right? And 3 is getting information only from 0, not other any of this 1 or 2, is it? So three, the robot number 3 is getting information only from the leader. This is a graph-based topology, okay? So a fixed graph-based directed graph we are using. Based on this communication topology, the robots will work and they will not collide at all also. You can see that there is no one-to-one communication over here. So, but still, we can see that how the robots will work. I'll show the video and again, the simulation and real-time experimental videos. Be careful. Let me take this video. So this is a simple experimentation. I hope this video is visible. If any issue, please let me know. So this is a simple experimentation with a 2 robot with a fuzzy logic based implementation. So here you can see one is a leader and this is a follower. So the experimental setup is nothing but we are using the Pioneer robots. This is the experiment done at IIT Kanpur when I was a student out there. So here, these are some Aruco markers being kept over there. This is to identify the distance separation between these members using an overhead camera system connected to an external PC. So this is to find this offset between the robots is detected using overhead camera only during the initial phase. Once robot starts moving, we are using audiometry to find it for this experimentation. So now the robots are at 1 meter or something. So it comes to 4.5 meter and follow that. So just testing the algorithm, just all the velocity manuals, acceleration, deceleration, then a left and right turn maneuver. That's it, we checked in the indoor environment, constrained environment. So only that those things will be tested. Just test the robustness of the algorithm. You can see this is a leader and follower. Okay. So here, just following this leader, and the leader is not aware of the path. Okay, only the follower is aware of the leader is aware of the path, follower is not aware of the path. It is just following the leader. Repeated experimentation. This is two robots, then comes to three robot case. So here, okay, these are two robots, same thing. So I will show the three robot. Robot, yes. So three robot case here. So we will see fault tolerant also. If one of the robots goes to faulty in real time. So three robots are making a triangular formation, and one leader different and the two followers at the backside. Leader is aware of the path, follower is not aware of the path. Leader is just detecting the follower positions and just tracking the leader. That's it. So fault case is the next experiment, as I told, as I've shown that experimentation, that real-time video. Three robots are here. The right one is going to faulty in real time. They are even communicating with all of them. So, but still, if one is faulty, it is isolated, but rest of the agents is reconfigured and the stability is not affected. That's a good basic. So even if one agent is deleted from the formation, rest of the agents will reconfigure and make the formation and will follow the follower, follow the leader and continue the mission. Okay. So this is this we are just testing the algorithms out here. This is previous one was similar platform. This is similar three Firebat 6 robots. So here we're making big formation. It's also all having onboard PC. You can see the top one is onboard PC. Sorry, again, repeated experimentation. Some different algorithms we tested for detection again, once again. Different test cases, different operating conditions, different tested. That's it. But it's making the formation. So we'll go to the next video quick. Next video that is on graph based topology. So this actually, what I've shown here, you have shown a graph actually. Robots are not five robots with one of the robots a leader, and second, all of the robots are the other robots are followers, is it? So then they're making a they are communicating using a communication graph. They are not all communicating between each other. So now here you see red is the leader and other agents are the followers. This is the pair stage simulator. I will show the real-time video also. Initially, the I will show this simulator, this is a video based on simulation. So see, you can see that. So they are making a triangular formation. It's a pair stage. So red one is the leader. Other thing are deputies or followers. Okay, so they are making a score shape formation, supposed to be. They're navigating, only leader is aware of the path. And now I'm going to perturb one by one and see how it is affected the formation. I will perturb it, I will just disturb one by one the agents. See, I'm just fine. First I'm trying to perturb the leader. You can see that all the agents are affected because leader is connected to all the agents. Now, when I just perturb this deputy number one, say that blue one maybe. Yes, yeah, deputy number three. Okay, so you can see the two members are affected. Leader is not affected because leader is not getting any feedback from the followers. It's not getting information. Now you can see we will perturb the other one, the blue one. If the blue one is perturbed, you can see only the green is affected. See, the cyan one and red are not affected. Why? Because these are not connected. It's not getting information from that. Because it is communicating using a graph. There is no one-to-one communication between that. Now, when I perturb green, see, look here. When we perturb green, nothing is affected. Is it? But still, they are not colliding. But with limited communication, they are making the formation and making and navigating, following the leader. Is it? When leader is perturbed, all the things are affected. is based on the plaster simulation. Now we'll come to, again, same thing, the scorcher formation. It is coming back to formation with a short span of time. Here is the real-time implementation of the same thing. This is event-triggered control. What I've done is event-triggered. Event-triggered means we are not sensing and we are not triggering the control at every sampling instance. But at certain event instances, we are giving the control triggers. So this is basically the real-time experimentation. Event-triggered control. So event-triggered control. Here you see 60 meters is supposed to come to 0.5 meters separation. The followers is the leader over here, the firebird supports and followers in the pioneer boards. So they are making the formation, they are accelerating. Different manuals, we have acceleration, deceleration, left and right turn manual. This is, is basically still stuck because here actually we are using the trigger. We are not sharing every sampling instance. It. That algorithm we tested to resource optimal that I've shown the second one. Okay, so this again repeat experimentation. So before that, since I was talking about multi-agent systems, okay, this is the multi-agent system, right? So we have multiple robots over here performing a task. So multi-agent system can be sometimes human following robot also. The human in the loop multi-agent system. One human is there and the robot is following a human being sometimes. So there are lots of applications for that. For example, an assistive robotics wheelchair following a human being. Okay, so they can see one of the experimentations done at IIT Kanpur, my lab there. So it's a work done by Dr. Meenakshi Gupta, my colleague over there. She's working human tracking. So here you can see a robot is coming and following the human and tracking that. So overhead camera, I mean onboard camera system here. It's tracking the human and following the human. Okay, here's a multi-agent system, but the human in the loop. So one of the agent is a human, leader is a human, the follower is basically a robot. So it's just following that leader, okay, with an offset. When actually, when this human is going out of field of view of the camera, so of course, actually the robot will stop. And again, improvisation has been done, like it will predict it based on the previous data. It will predict actually what is the, it will forecast it, this one. The actual position of the leader and will comes back to the formation. Now we can see that here. So when he is going out of field of view of the camera, you can see that robot will stop. That way it has been controlled. Now when coming back to the field of view, it will start navigating again. Okay, so this is one thing that's in the indoor environment. But coming to this is another experimentation, the outdoor environment, the robot for human following robot. You can see that. So this is actually view from the onboard camera. So that's why the robot is not visible. But offboard camera also we will show. You see, the robot is following her. Is it? Even occlusions and autoplane rotations are having, she's making that, right? Some people are occluding, see? Some people are coming and intentional occlusions are added, but still it's working, right? It's following the human. So this is as applications in assistive robotics. If you can fix a chair or this mobile robot base, it becomes a mobile wheelchair, right? So it will follow the human, is it? So it's following that human. It's an outdoor environment. Kinect camera been used or on onboard. This the previous one was offboard camera. So onboard camera, this is with offboard camera. So see, you can see the intensely some occlusions are added and even outer plane rotations also sometimes see, but the robot is tracking the human, right? So here the robot is, this is the pioneer robot, is having built-in PC, but for image processing, it has been bypassed using a laptop, an ISO laptop. And again, camera is used is Kinect camera for getting the depth information also. So many occlusions, you can see that many of many occlusions and disturbances are in the environment, right? But still it is following exactly that leader. This is at IIT Kanpur, Intel Systems and Control Lab. So this is also a multi-agent system. Okay. So but human in the loop. So lots of applications for this multi-agent systems. This is in assistive robotics. This particular application being implemented. All right. So here, Now, one more thing, I just want to quickly show this video. I'm not going to show completely because this is an experimentation on cyber physical robotics. So here, this basically robots are communicating using relay communication. Okay, one robot will communicate the data with the immediate neighbor, then that to the base station like that. But actually, the relay communication, here this is a pioneer robot for adjusting distance, and they are basically communicating for this area. Relay communication, just like button is transport, data is transferred from the data. Data will send it, it will be to the relay robot will communicate that. Here actually we use this, I found this video just to show another simulator, you can even use it. This is similar to school mobile sim. Okay, this sim, this will work with ROS also. So this, using this simulator also, the sim algorithm has been implemented. Okay, this is also for relay communication. Multiple robots are here. So they are communicating, they are basically communicating between each other and as well as with the access point. And again, data from the service point sends and will give to the access point. Yes, actually, that's all the videos. Time is very limited. These are the experimental results I was planning to show, but with this limited time, it's quite difficult to show all these results and explain these things. So, but I can tell one thing, if you're interested in this area, multi-robot systems, you can contact me also anytime. And you can refer my publications, which I've done in this area. And this work which I explained is based on my publications, for this all publications. So you can refer this if you want to know more about this works and all my textbook also in intelligent control robotic systems, and you can contact me. Okay. So that's all from my side. So now it's open for questions if you have anything.
Thank you, sir, for such an informative and interesting session. It was really a capsule of knowledge. Now let's move on to the doubt clearing session. Participants, it's your time. Please put down your doubts in the comment box of YouTube.
Is there any doubts?
So till now we have no doubts coming up. Okay. We'll wait for two more minutes.
Okay.
Participants, please come up with your doubts. And here we have Emmanuel Manu with his doubt.
Okay.
How is the real-time decision making is done?
Real-time decision making, I told you, we have a controller, right? So we have a onboard, the controller is nowadays nothing, it's a computer, it's a computer-based onboard PC we are having. So there's a control software, and the algorithm, I didn't explain much because I didn't get time for explain the control algorithm being used. Okay. So we have the control sliding, fuzzy sliding mode I implemented in this case for the decision-making. Yeah, are you talking about control? But decision making, I don't understand. There are many decision making, is a very broad term. So one is like actually the path, the control perspective I'm talking about. Okay. Streamlining the behavior of the system. So that is done using control software. So that is being designed based on fuzzy sliding mode algorithm. There are many improvisations I have done. So fuzzy sliding mode, fast adaptive gain sliding mode. So even event triggered also, there's another algorithm being used for decision making.
Thank you, sir. I feel Emmanuel Manu has been clarified with his doubt.
Yes. Okay.
And now we have another question. That is, can we apply this to drones also?
Yes, of course.
It will be impossible to carry laptop.
No, there's drones basically for what purpose, which application? I'm talking about multi-robot. All the algorithms implemented can be implemented in drones also. But laptop in the sense, I didn't get actually. Because laptop in the sense, before which application? Laptop, but nowadays actually many drones are coming with good computation capability also. Okay, onboard computing power. So we are having that. Even Jetson, I know there are many other good AI-enabled these things are drones are also available nowadays. Is it? So these are like very good platforms are available. So you don't need an onboard laptop. So onboard laptop is used in that case actually because that robot is having onboard PC which is very outdated. Okay, the processor is not at all good enough for MS processing. So AI-based application also we need at least some i7 or i5 processors and. So that's why we are bypassing that and using a laptop. Okay. Otherwise, it's fine with now drones. Actually, anyway, you are not going to use it for this application, the wheelchair application, right? And we have good cameras also. Is the doubt clear? Drones, but the other thing is like all the algorithms implemented in multi-robot systems can be extended to drones also. I told you my most of work was in this pipeline detection, pipeline oil and gas leakage detection in these pipelines and desert lands. So they are basically using drone with the Land Rover. Okay, drones have some problem like battery carrying capacity is limited for that. So we need a mobile charging station. Is it? So that has to be followed also. So there's a coordination between this the coordination with the drone and the Land Rover is needed. That becomes a multi-robot system framework. Even not only for that, if I'm aerial spraying and all multiple drones have been deployed. So all the cases we can go for this coordination algorithm. So they will coordinate with each other for performing a task. We can do that. Cooperative transportation, sometimes the drones are used. All the cases, basically control algorithm will be same actually. Only the agent dynamics is different. In the case of drones, in case of a simple robot, we may need a first order simple dynamics or kinematic model is enough. But when it goes to drones, we may need a second order, third order, fourth order. We may need a velocity dynamics for a simply mobile robot to design a controller. But for a drone, maybe sometimes for robust design, we may need acceleration, jerk, or in snap dynamics. Or sometimes people are using to design high fidelity designs. Okay. Otherwise, the algorithm will be same for all. Is it clear?
I think the participant is clear with the doubt. Okay. And now we have another participant with this doubt. Okay. That is a program to follow a specific thing only. So what if any interference occur?
Can you please repeat the question?
The question is it programmed to follow a specific thing only? Thing. So what if any interference occur?
The thing means because I have shown many applications. Someone is like a human following. Okay, in that case, it's a template matching. Okay, which suppose assisted robotics. If your robot is supposed to follow the human, so it's supposed to follow that particular human only. Because the template matching is born, the template has to be initially the template is stored. It is not like that initially, but human can be changed also sometimes. But initially, template is taken. It has been the image is captured, and based on the template, actually, it will keep on tracking that. But actually, initially, few seconds, actually, it will take some time to capture that image of the particular human. But even if the human is changed, it will work for the new person also. If it is that is the case. And second thing, I don't know, are you talking about multi-robot system? Multi-robot system, I work with heterogeneous system also. You can see that. So it is not like only to work with all similar types of platforms or similar objects. If you add a new object, new node or a mobile node, also it will work perfectly. But it has to be added, of course. It should be because it need to communicate, right? It need to communicate with their members. So you should be aware of that, actually, the ID of that particular node being added. That's it. Otherwise, it will work. It is not with a specific node. It can be a similar platform, and a similar platform, it will work. Additions are possible. Additions and deletions are possible. That's what I have shown. Okay. The members is possible.
And Jishnu is with one more doubt. Can it follow more than one person?
Can it follow more than one person? Basically, it's difficult. With this algorithm, it's not. There is a human slot. For a single human, it has been, this human tracking has been done. Okay. So multi-human it will not. That's why actually you can see the occlusions are happening. So they just not stopping there. You can see that video. One person is the occlusions, intentional occlusions are being made, right? Is it? So in that case, actually, the robot is exactly following one human only. Suppose that case, we are doing it for one human. Multiple human, we can work on it. Okay, we can make it actually. But for this particular application, we need this robot to follow only single human. Okay, assistive robotics. That's why we done it for it.
So we think Jishnu is clear about his doubt. And by this, we come to an end of the session as we think the queries are all over.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Rasta, for IEEE Kerala section. And I would like to thank Dr. Disha for inviting me. And thank you so much, the students are also.
And now we present a memento poster to Sir Dr. Ranjita Nair as a token of thanks from the team. And once again, we thank you, sir, for spending some of your valuable time here with us.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for your patience.
And now, participants, please don't forget to fill up the feedback form which is provided in the chat box. We would really like to know about your valuable feedbacks and it will be considered for the certificate. Before winding up the session, we would like to remind you all that tomorrow's session will be on robotic guided surgery using machine learning by Arjun B.S., PhD scholar from Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. And thus, we the team of Insights in 20 are concluding our today's session and will meet you all in the next session. Till then, we are taking leave. Thank you. Thank you so much.